Yeah, so thanks for coming to this session. My name is Buddhasevaka. I'm in Manchester in the UK. And joining me are, I'll do my introductions now, actually. So I'll bring my sheet of paper up. So my name's Buddhasevaka, as I say, from Manchester. My partner, father of three, Dharma practitioner. And MSer, which means a person who has multiple sclerosis. So actually I found the Dharma invaluable in helping me, deal with this. And I've sort of developed a series of meditations to help me kind of relax and come into sort of groundedness with the earth because I'm more sort of spasming and crazy things like that. So nice to see everyone here. Actually, I wonder whether you could spotlight the person that I'm talking about, which is next. It's going to be Manuel Hornich. Sorry. So he works as a teacher in a primary school in Berlin, also part-time working for the Berlin Teachers Union. So this is a shortened version of the spiel that Manuel gave me, but it's because we have a full house of five of us in. So I'll just continue. So he became a Mitra in 2021, and so in April of this year, he started engaging with the exile Buddhist in Berlin, who were leading a meditation watch, which then led to the formation of the Tree Rat Earth Sangha in Berlin. That's quite an exciting development. So that's Manuel from Berlin. So now we've got Lou Hewson, who's from Sheffield. She's a training for ordination Mitra with the Sheffield Sangha. And so she's part of the group, which is called the Work That Reconnects Network, which is like an interesting John O'Macy type group there, which is actually led by Kemisuri. She has two kids. She lives just outside of Sheffield in the UK. And she runs a small cafe and she also grows flowers for a living. And she founded a project called the Flying Horse Lawn, which promotes open air living and education. That's very exciting too. And so we've got Akasha Raja, who was ordained in 2001. He has a partner and two kids. He's taken part in several actions with the exiled Buddhists, and he's actually chair of the Shrewsbury Buddhist Centre in the UK, and actually one of the co-founders of the Tree Rat Earth Sangha. So I'm really pleased that we've got him today. In his other work, he does translation from German to English. That's very handy for our German people. So Helen Clark, last but not least, Helen is a Mitra. She's been with the Newcastle Sangha for 10 years. She worked for a whole career in mental health for the NHS, but is now retired. She now volunteers in an organic market garden and works with Earth Sangha. Her work with Earth Sangha includes tree planting and climate change workshops. So we're the people that are going to speak for a bit at the start. And so we then invite you to go into breakout rooms for the sort of middle part of the session today. And at the end, we're just going to come back for a plenary session. So as I say, if you want to be in the German speaking breakout room, if you just add Deutsch to your name or rename yourself as that, will make it easy for a Bechabria to get to. So we've got several. Well, we've got three questions that we're going to discuss today, and we're going to put these in the chat. In fact, I might just put these in the chat now. So it's done. Just 1 second. I'll do that. And just to say, actually, I'm the convener or the facilitator for the local conveners in the Tree Rat Earth Sangha. I do that job now. Akasha Raja used to do that job, so we've got a bit of a shared knowledge of of that. Let me just find the chat and then post these questions in. All right. So it'll be a sec. Someone else has done it. Now, so the three questions that we're going to discuss today is how do we respond to the climate crisis on an individual level? How we respond as an order and movement, and who and what needs to happen in the world next in order for us to have a livable world, basically. So we've got, so this is a social session. It's a chance to talk to each other, and it's not us talking at you. We will be talking amongst ourselves, just those people that I've just introduced at the start. But then, as I say, we do invite you to go into breakout rooms and to discuss amongst yourselves, really. So yeah, so shall we kick off amongst ourselves with a discussion about those subjects, my fellow table dwellers? Just put the chat back up now so I can see the questions again. I can see at least one person who speaks Spanish. Maybe we can have a group. Three people. Yeah, if there's a Spanish contingent in, then I don't know whether you could put Spanish next to your name, and I'm sure that a picture break could put you in a Spanish speaking group, because I'm sure my accent isn't all that understandable by people who aren't from the UK. So yeah, so that's a great idea. So my current reflection is, I wonder whether stillness, simplicity, and contentment, which is a third Buddhist precept that we take, I wonder whether that can be quite a big deal for us. And the reason why I say this is because we're, coming up to Christmas, and the shops are full of plastic tat, which I'm sure we picked up and only ever played with a small number of times, and then discarded. It's shocking for me to realize and reflect on that every piece of plastic that's ever been produced since 1900s, whenever plastic was introduced, is still around today, and it's absolutely everywhere. And so that kind of so that's just one reflection that I was having this morning. I actually lead a meditation group in the mornings for the Buddhist Center online. And so I was kind of, I actually gave an Albert Einstein quote, which was very much concerned with trying to be happy with what we have, and stillness, simplicity, and contentment. Let me just find the quote. Just one second. Yeah, so he said in the 1940s. Any intelligent fool can make things bigger and more complex, more violent. It takes a touch of genius and a lot of courage to move in the opposite direction. So what do people think about stillness, simplicity, and contentment in our group? I think that could be a key to reducing our waste, reducing pollution. What do we think? We need to start to, from an individual basis, and then work outwards. That's my thinking.
Shall we just go in any order,
Yeah,
Buddhasevaka?
just fire away.
Yeah. Well, in terms of how I've responded, or I am responding individually, I've done a bit of renunciation. So I've renounced my car, and I've renounced my job that gave very little space for stillness, simplicity, and contentment. And I think that's made an amazing difference. I think it's moved me from, well, it's given me a much more time to do nice things at the Buddhist Center. So as I said, I'm doing the work that reconnects work with Kimasori. And we did 10 weeks with Kimasori because she's very kindly passing on all her skill of the last 20 years to us, because she's been practicing this for some time. And I realized, you know, I wanted solutions, and I wanted solutions really quickly. And since May, when we started this, she has convinced me that it's not about solutions. So I worked as a lawyer for 25 years, so that was all about solutions. And I'm now completely convinced that it's not about solutions. I am completely settling into a life of stillness, simplicity, and contentment. And I have a, I don't know if anyone, no, one of the interpretations of Adistana is grace waves. And I have just picked this up as something really rather beautiful. And I genuinely feel that the best thing I can do is meditate and practice the Brahma Viharas and sort of contribute to those grace waves of friendship and generosity, you know, that we all know are flowing around the world. We can't see them, we can't touch them. But I genuinely think that my practice, yeah, can contribute to those, and that they will, you know, hopefully reign supreme against less graceful things that are going on in the world. And another thing I've picked up from work that reconnects is the Ekasattva vows, which I don't think are specific to Joanna Macy's work. I think the exiled Buddhists have a number of Ekasattva vows, all very similar. But the first one is just living more lightly in the world. And I think if I just take that one and practice that for the rest of my life, you know, that will make a, I hope, a significant contribution as an individual.
I don't think it's possible to live without damaging the earth, I was thinking. But then I was thinking, well, surely we can do something to then put, you know, to restore something, or as a, you know, it's not all about damage. Well, it shouldn't all about be all about damage limitation. Surely, I mean, the most obvious things is doing things like planting trees and stuff like this. But that seems to me like it's more of an optimistic outlook. And I think obviously, yeah, by changing to electric vehicles, you know, recycling, living ethically, ethical banking, and vegan diet, etc. They're all sort of they all seem to me to be like damage limitation. But surely we can be positive. We can put something back in. I'm just not sure how that looks like at the moment.
Well, I've got some thoughts on that. So, I mean, I think one of the risks that we run as Buddhists and as a Buddhist tradition is to be perceived as being quietist. And by quietist, I mean that, you know, the tendency just to sort of take, you know, to sort of not withdraw from involvement. You know, we could sort of bring a justification that, well, it's all impermanent, you know, it's we're all going to die, and, you know, why not? Why bother, you know? So I completely agree with Lou. I completely agree with and you with your premise that is the sort of basis on which that we act as Buddhists. But I think we can also, that can be a positive contribution to the world where we are seen to be acting, to be living out those values of stillness, simplicity, and contentment. So I'm thinking of the kind of actions that I've been on with exiled Buddhists, and a number of us have been on, where we, in the midst of the mayhem of a kind of extinction rebellion protest, a few of us just sitting demonstratively and demonstrably quiet. And I think that says something really powerful. I mean, it's there's the bearing witness, there's that sort of being rooted in the earth, but there's also showing people that there is another way, that there is a better way of living. There is a, you know, there's a different paradigm, if you like. And I think we can take that model out into the world. And one of the things which we haven't got yet in Shrewsbury, but I'm very interested in instituting, is the big sit. You know, which is more of a general kind of, it's a sort of anti-consumerist rallying cry, I guess.
Yeah.
But also presenting, so there's two things happening. You're kind of making a statement, but you're also saying here is an alternative. And that's what I think is one of the special contributions. I mean, I know I'm going on to the collective, but I think for me, in my terms of my personal practice, that's I think there's quite a powerful message there, as you know, as individuals.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the big city is something that I'm very interested in, and I've been doing in Manchester for over a year now. And so we do it on the second Saturday of the month. We did it outside Next in Manchester just last weekend, last Saturday. And there was that many people with shopping bags there and just saw us sitting quietly. And we were sat there with QR codes on our chests, with banners. I was giving out leaflets, which, you know, directed people to the website and the Facebook page. And there is definitely, a different way to go about business. I mean, that many people just stopped and, you know, that many people scanned the QR code on our chest. Gave out about 20 leaflets, so there's definitely there's interest in. I'm not sure if it's yet the voice is loud enough for people to be diverted, and I just want the voice to be loud enough before before it's it's this do or die basically. So we need to act now. I mean, I was reading something today. On the BBC website that said climate change is happening, you know, faster than any experts thought it would. And so the clock is ticking, and perhaps even faster than we once thought. So, yeah, so I think this message needs to come across. We need to do everything in our powers to, and I'm really passionate about this. I've got kids, and I don't want them or their kids to grow up in a world which is vastly different to the one that we've enjoyed. But I do think a change of behaviour is what we need, and we need it fast, really. I wonder what you guys think, Helen and Manuel. Do you do big sits in your places respectively?
We don't in Newcastle as yet. We're quite a small sangha, so I guess that's something we're working towards. But I suppose how I respond to the question is that it is, to me, it's about long-term practice. It's, you know, there is that sense of urgency, but we do have to think in the long term, I think, actually, in terms of bringing about the societal change that needs to happen. And we can do that in small and large ways. So because we're quite a small sangha and quite a small earth sangha group, we a lot of what we do is support each other with the things that we're doing, as well as, you know, doing small scale things in the centre. To me, it's about, it's a bit like the layers of an onion. I was thinking about what Lou was saying, and it's like carrying on working in our practice to make our lives more simple. And there kind of isn't really an end to that, I don't think. You just have to keep on thinking about how can I use less? How can I consume less? How can I encourage the people around me to do that? So talking to other people. And the other thing, I suppose, I was thinking as we were talking, what I was thinking about is gratitude. It's kind of like that to me is one of the ways into simple living. It's about being grateful for all the small things that we have. You know, the fact that we do live at the moment in a peaceful society, the fact that we do have access to some wildlife. Yes, I know that there is a lot of diversity loss, but really cherishing the things that we do have, and that can really start to shift things, because, you know, it's always a balance of feeling, you know, overwhelm and despair with a lot of what's happening around us. So I find gratitude really helps me to keep going and to to feel like I can pace myself, gratitude and compassion, both for myself and other beings. I don't know what you think, Manuel, about that.
Yes, I agree. Well, we haven't done a big sit yet in Berlin. As Buddhasevaka said, we started as a group taking part in an action in a walking meditation that was organized by XR Buddhists. And then the people that were there from the Triratna Sangha, we agreed to meet again. And now we meet regularly as an Earth Sangha in Berlin. And well, at the moment, we are trying to find out what that means, actually. So, that's the stage where we are. And I agree with what you said about simplicity and stillness, contentment, of course. Yes, and about, basically looking at my own lifestyle and what I can contribute. But I must say, I'm a bit confused by what Lou said when it's not about solutions. Of course, it's about, from an activist perspective, if you look at activism from a dharmic perspective, then it's about taking things more easily, being less, less strict and more open. So that's maybe what you want to say, Lou. And I do relate with that. But in the end, I think it is about solutions. We have to, we have to come up with some kind of solution because the situation is urgent. And so, my personal view is that I really have the feeling that the Dharma and studying the Dharma and being with others in the Earth Sangha in particular helps me to find new perspectives and actually to carry on with my, as Buddhasevaka said, I'm a unionist. That's my main field of action. I really need a source of energy and a source of wisdom to carry on with this. That's what I feel. Not only unionism in general, being active in society. So I feel if I'm, I'm being confronted with this crisis, with this multiple crisis in the world, it's easy to despair. It's easy to become cynical. And so this is what I'm looking for in the Dharma context.
Thanks, Manuel. Lou, I wonder whether you wanted to come back to Manuel on.
So clearly we are looking for solutions, and that I think is probably our third question, what needs to happen next in the world? And you can listen to some amazing TED Talks by Al Gore, who has all the facts on this in his head, and he can work, and loads of people can. I think from an individual point of view, it almost becomes a type of craving if you think individually you can find the solution. What I like, and I have to say, that I did feel like that, I thought I can do something here, I can sort this. I can't. I absolutely can't. But what I can do is contribute to the drip, drip, drip. And we don't know when that is going to emerge as the solution. But I think if we think positively and we really believe in what we do and, the work and the work we do in society, the work we do for a living is genuinely, what do we call it? Right within the Eightfold Path. Our drip drips, an avalanche could happen tomorrow, but I don't know when that's going to be. And I think it's a waste of my energy individually to think that I can control that. I can't.
We can only do what we can do, can't we? And like Helen said, like an onion, layers, hopefully, like waves, we can have a positive influence on those around me. I mean, I do an in-person class at the Manchester Buddhist Centre on a Tuesday, and because my house is, the Buddhist Centre is halfway between my house and where the kids are, I buy them a book, an environmental book, every week, just on the second-hand shelves at the Buddhist Centre, and I give it to them. And I'm sure that it ends up as a doorstop or something, or it gets discarded, but I can only bring them to water in, well, obviously I'll try and make it clear, because obviously for those speaking other languages won't understand that, but I can only be an influence, I can't be a force upon them. So hopefully by, you know, in time and with effort, the individual influences that we have will make a collective difference. I mean, my other half is very optimistic about this. She's sure that if we do the right thing now, you know, people around us will listen, and then the people around them, you know, it'll be like a societal thing. You know, like when, like it back in the 70s, when it was okay to have a drink and get behind the wheel, and then overnight, nearly, it became a no-go. So I think I'm hoping that a similar thing will happen, in that, you know, if you don't, you know, if you drive a petrol car, if you do this, if you don't do that, I think society will then make it so that, yeah, that person is, you know, it feels pretty small as a result of their actions. And I think that's where the collective change can happen. Just by that, I mean, yeah, shall I ring the bell? Should we move on to the, what can we do as an order and a movement?
Okay, can I say something to that?
Oh, yeah.
I think in a way, unfortunately, I have to question the whole premise of that question. Because to say, what, in a way, can you say that we as an order and movement can do anything collectively? Because, you know, we're not a group. Well, we are a group, but, you know, we're a group that's aspiring to be a spiritual community.
Yeah,
it's a free association of individuals. So I think it's very difficult, or you know, it's probably a little bit futile to sort of think in terms of what the order, say, can have a collective order position or a collective movement position, because that doesn't sit with this sort of model of spiritual community.
So
I don't think we can have a position, but I certainly think that we can kind of, well, as we are doing, is we can associate with like-minded individuals who share the same concerns, and there are things that we can do in our communities, and you know, you're talking about the drip drip. There are things that we can do in the world, but everyone has to decide on the basis of their, or even on the basis of their own practice, their own convictions, their own sense of what is right. So we can't really sort of expect to come up with a collective statement about what the order and movement and do, you see what I mean? So I just wanted to sort of, I wasn't around to discuss the questions, but it just struck me that there's a view there, which is it's a strongly sort of influenced by societal norms, that groups have collective positions, like political parties have a collective position, and then they get whipped into line and that sort of thing. So I think it's a more difficult area than that. And believe me, you could, even if you tried your hardest to get a collective position from the order, those of us who are in the order, we know that is just never going to happen.
Yeah.
Can I say something about that?
Yeah.
Because I feel like I'm taking some inspiration from some stuff I've been reading about the Climate Majority Project, which has a very clear, it's on the moderate flank of XR, and it's a very well thought out model of change. And one of the things that they talk about, for example, is truthfulness. And I think that's certainly something, you know, that's one of our precepts. So it is about the truthfulness of, you know, climate change and the meta crisis. So that's something, in a way, yeah, whether you say it's as an order or a movement, we're all, you know, we may not be united necessarily in quite the same way, but that's something that we can all do. We can all speak the truth as far as we can recognize it. And I suppose one of the other things that the Climate Majority talks about is cultures of awareness and resilience. And to me, that's a key part that our centers play to, you know, people come to Buddhist centres for refuge quite often, for refuge from the rampant materialism of the societies in which we live. And that's, and a lot of the practices we teach are about awareness and are about developing resilience. So I feel like that's, I don't know that that would be necessarily that contentious. All, I would imagine that all the centres are doing that, you know, that's one of their aims to some degree, that we're actually serving our communities, that we're helping people to develop aware, personal awareness and greater awareness and some level of resilience. Yeah. A lot of our practices are about that, aren't they?
Yeah. I mean, I was having this conversation with Padma Vajra not long ago, on, you know, on this, because I was talking about Just Stop Oil and stuff, and we would, and he was talking about, and we, our service to humanity is to practice and spread the Dharma. And I completely agree, Helen, that of course we teach, we know we teach awareness, we encourage people to become aware, we encourage people to make ethical choices. But that's the sort of, in a sense, from that we can't go, we can't then say this is a collective position. I think we, you know, we're encouraging people to develop individuality, you know, that's based on their ethics and, you know, and whatever, you know, level of insight people in, into the true nature of things that people can obtain. And, you know, people will then, you know, develop their own positions. And then, as I say, those of us who feel of like mind, you know, we can and we will come together. I don't think we're disagreeing with each other. I think it's just a sort of, you know.
Yeah.
And it's because of the order that we're here today, which is a great thing. And it's a great thing that you guys have encouraged, you know, local TES conveners. I don't know, I thought I'd just tell you about some of the things we do in Sheffield. So we have pujas in the Peak. We're right on the edge of the Peak District. And I think actually probably people from Manchester and Newcastle, maybe Birmingham, have joined us on some of those. And so we have, we went through the female Buddhism bodhisattvas, and various people put together absolutely beautiful pujas, literally sitting on a ledge overlooking Grindleford in the Peak District. So, you know, just being in contact with greenery and outside, I think changes neural pathways a bit, but all totally in the context of what we do best in terms of teaching the Dharma. And I've talked about the WTR network, and I do think that provides a really useful way in for some people into Buddhism. We do tree planting days. We take part in the Sheffield Climate Vigil, which is a group of, you know, multi-faith individuals who meet each Monday and sit quietly with placards, as you say, on the steps of Sheffield Town Hall. And we're beginning to get involved in COP events as well. So I think, as you say, I mean, our practice goes on at Sangha Night and Mitra Study and all the things you would expect. But just having a ripple effect out into the wider community in a gentle way, I think is something which we're doing. And it's because of the Earth Sangha.
Can I come in on that? Because Akash Raja, why did you found the Earth Sangha? Did you think it was necessary at that point, but then your thinking has changed? Or?
Oh, I'm not saying it's not. I mean, I didn't found it. I mean, I was just one of many.
Oh, yeah.
I wouldn't lay claim to that. No. No, I mean, it's absolutely needed. Not. It's I'm not for a moment saying that we shouldn't have a tree about the Earth Sangha. All I'm saying is that it can't speak for the whole order and movement.
No.
You know, just that really. Just, you know, just sort of clarification of terms.
Yeah.
Maybe the question is not how do we respond as an order and a movement, but how do we respond in the order and the movement?
Oh, was that the question?
Which topics do we raise? Which questions do we raise? Okay. And
Because I'm a relatively new order member. I was only ordained about 2 years ago, and I was thinking, oh, surely all order members, surely they're, you know, they're there to be with me. And I was shocked to find out that actually that's really not the case. No. But like as Helen said, surely it's something. I don't want to politicize it, but sometimes I don't think there's a choice, because surely, I'm going to vote for the Green Party of the next election. But I was thinking also that, for example, our Buddhist Center, I'm just scanning the people. Hopefully I won't get in trouble for this, but... our Buddhist center doesn't want us to be political. It doesn't want us to speak to, you know, as a climate cooler and as a Manchester Earth Sangha collective. Mm-hmm. It's in the mandate that we don't speak to Just Stop Oil, or we don't speak to XR, mm-hmm. you know, we don't align ourselves with them. But is there going to become a point that, will there be a time that, surely that has to change, you know, as time goes on, and the Rishi Sunak's not listening, and you know, China and India are still doing their thing. Surely it will be more political for us not to align with people that don't agree with the continual desecration of the earth.
Well, I think that's where the Trivatna Earth Sangha comes in, is a sort of an apolitical response to the climate emergency that doesn't identify with right or left. I mean, like you, I had this assumption for ages in the order that everyone subscribed to the same left-wing liberal consensus. And it was like you, I was quite surprised to find that that wasn't the case. There's actually a huge spectrum of political views within the order and within the movement. So it's not safe just to say we all believe the same thing. Mm. But I think that, you know, the Trivatna Earth Sangha goes some way to address that issue. Is how do we do activism in a way which is based firmly on Dharmic principles, you know, which doesn't hate, which is non-confrontative. You know, I think XR has an admirable kind of intention, but my experience of it is that it people naturally and understandably do polarize strongly, and there is, you know, do give expression to lots to ill will, and fully understandably, I completely get the passion and the desperation. But you know, we can't let go of the kind of karma. You know, we can't let go of our own responsibility to be ethical, to practice metta, you know, the Brahma Viharas, I think you were talking about, Lou. And you know, when I was instrumental in setting up XR in Shrewsbury, and I rather naively at the first meeting I said I'd like us to practice non-violence of body, speech and mind, and people kind of went, yeah that sounds great. And of course, do you know it's so much to expect of people, but it's not too much for us to expect of ourselves.
But it's interesting that the XR position has changed. It seems to have softened. Just Stop Oil seem to be the ones that are sort of going out and doing the sort of quite confrontational action. Mm. It seems, as Helen was saying, the founder of XR seems to have created a new sort of movement, which seems to be a bit more softly spoken about these things. So maybe that's that's the way things are going in society, or have identified to need to go, if you know what I mean.
It means the grace waves are working.
Yeah. And so what did you think of that XR offshoot then, Helen? Was it, do you reckon it's got some legs?
Well, I just wanted to bring Manuel in, because I don't know whether you had anything specific to say to that, Manuel, a bit earlier on, possibly not.
Well, yes, as I said, I think the question is which topics we raise within the movement. And one thing that really is, well, I'm thinking about very often is, just the fact, you know, from Berlin, it's quite common to fly to England for 1 week or 2 weeks to retreat. And I really wonder how much carbon we cause by just this retreat tourism. Of course, it's maybe a specific problem from a German perspective, and we are building our own center now near Berlin. Maybe this will be a solution at some point, but it's, well, I'm just saying this because it's really something that troubles me, and not so sure what to think about this, because there are of course good reasons to fly to retreat, and usually it's not possible to travel by train or by bus. It is possible, but it's more expensive. It takes more time, and but it's an example. Well, you just said, Akasha Raja, you spoke about an apolitical stance on climate issues. I wonder what this is. I think you have to, if you like it or not, at some point you have to take a, it's all political. Well, don't have to discuss about what political means, but it's, I think at some point we are just forced to take a stand on certain questions, we like it or not.
The stand we take is based on our own, on our practice of the Dharma, rather than a kind of political agenda or a party manifesto. I completely agree. I mean, I wouldn't say that we don't, you know, it would be, I think it would be a misunderstanding to say that being Buddhist means you never take a stand on anything. You know, it does say the Buddha is said to have had no views, but I think that that's a bit of a distraction. Of course we take a stand, but it's, you know, it's not like it's not a tribal stand. It's not a stand that then excludes and polarizes with other people who don't agree with us. I think that's really important. I mean, from my take on things. I just wanted to speak to the flying. I mean, I share the same pain, the same dilemma about flying. But I intend to fly to India for the Order Convention in 2025. I don't do that lightly, but I do it because I think there's a trade-off between there's a balance between the carbon you admit and the cause of a unified order. And I think if we, you know, I suppose that would bring the risk that the order kind of fragments and fractures if bits of the order never see other bits of the order. So I think there's a trade-off there potentially.
Yeah, I definitely do trade-offs all the time, because my condition is such that I produce plastic waste, and I don't have a choice about that. Well, I'm going to detail about, you know, what exactly that is, but sometimes I think, it's a trade-off. You know, I'm sitting in the streets, I'm putting all this effort into making websites, doing social media, you know, doing this conference, doing everything, you know, buying my kids' books. I still have to pollute the planet with this bit of plastic, but, you know, otherwise I won't be able to do half the things that I do. I'll be rendered sort of incapable of doing those things. So that's the first thing. But the second thing is, well, I think aviation is also something that troubles me, because I don't know whether we're ever going to be able to make aviation you know, sustainable, green. You know, I don't, unless there's a hydrogen powered jet engine that can be produced, which produces water as a waste product, I don't really see how aviation can become green. It's something that's here to stay. I don't think that's ever going to go. So maybe that is another trade-off that we have to accept. You know, when we do, like you said, Akash Raj, and when we're doing all these things in society to try and effect a change, you know, we need to be able to get to certain places in order to make that change. So Manuel, I don't know whether you feel like that in Germany, do you? Because it's sort of quite, you know, you said there's a lot of people who fly over to England and fly back. Would you share that standpoint?
Which standpoint?
Well, it's a trade-off. You're doing these things, but there are things that can offset that, you know.
Yeah, well, if you are, I think if we are honest to ourselves, it's very, very difficult to offset flying and other things that we do, like using plastic products. And as you said, I fully agree that it's very hard to exist in our world without doing these things. And I try to avoid flying, but I'm not completely avoiding it. I think I didn't have very good reasons for every flight that I did in my life. So yeah, it's I think there's no solution in really short term to this problem.
Well, the plastics thing is something that has been really bugging me. I don't know whether my other half tells me this. I don't know whether she's right, but is there some sort of fish that can that something like that eats plastic and then makes it compostable or something?
There's a kind of bacteria that are being discovered that will eat plastic. Because
that is going to be so important, I think, because we've got so much plastic. We just made a complete we destroyed the planet with plastic, I think, and so there's going to have to be some sort of bacteria or mass-produced substance that gets rid of what is in every kid's stocking this Christmas.
I think it's multi-stranded, isn't it? Because there's those individual things and being curious about them and educating ourselves. But to me, there is also something about having a sense of how change can happen, you know, and being, you know, recognizing obviously where we can bring a Buddhist view to that, but we're part of a you know, obviously a larger culture, and we can, you know, we can be part of that change. That's why I found some of the ideas behind the Climate Majority Project helpful, because it's a very well thought out theory of change and about how large some of the systems are that need to change. And that's only going to happen by working as a majority. So, you know, back to Akasha Raj's point about how, in a way, we need to bring everyone along rather than, you know, polarizing, because that there's so much of that in society at the moment, isn't there? I believe this, you believe that. So we you know, we're well placed within the Buddhist tradition to think about how do we listen to other people, how do we practice empathic listening, how do we, you know, help to pull people together, bring everyone along, and, you know, try and build a majority of people who want change on a wider level. I know that's a huge project, but to me that's part of what we as Buddhists can input to, I think.
I've got one eye on the time. Kashraj,
Well, I was just going to go off on a whole new topic, so maybe we don't have the time. I don't know.
Shall we? Or not?
Well, it was just, I was thinking about, you know, the solutions question. And, you know, we're trying to get, like, this majority together to find solutions and to sort of make everything better. And, you know, and to sort of actually solve the climate crisis. But I think as a spiritual community, we would still have a role to play, an important role to play, if we fail to solve it. You know, assuming that, you know, that the human race doesn't go extinct. And I think there's probably fairly good chances that the human race and human society will continue in some recognizable form. Then we still have a role. You know, our practice and our kind of the way that we show a particular way of life, still, there's still, you know, there's still plenty for us to do, so to speak. Remember Saraha, was it one of these conferences that Saraha was talking about how we could either be the pole bearers performing the funeral rites over the human race, or we could be the midwives at the birth of a new society.
That was
really interesting. Yeah, so, you know, I think I mean, obviously, we want to find solutions and be part of the solution, but I think that, you know, our role as Buddhists kind of potentially goes beyond that.
Yeah. Thanks, Emma. Just with the one eye on the time, what do you think about having a break or going into breakout rooms, or should we?
Yeah, a little break might be good.
A little break, yeah. Should we have? Should we come back at 5 o'clock? Then we can have half an hour in breakout rooms, and then have a bit of a session at the end.
Yeah, good.
Okay. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. So I hope you had a good group discussion. We certainly did. So I was just wondering if there was anything that anyone would like to bring to the wider session.
Buddhasevaka, you might need to repeat that so that the Germans can understand the translation. They need to get into the room first, and when they're in the room, then they can hear the translation.
Okay. Yeah, so I think everyone's back now. Just had a really good conversation in our group. I'm keen to hear any feedback that you have from yours. So go ahead and feedback if you wish.
I can say something about our group discussion, if you like, Buddhasevaka.
Oh, yes, please.
We had a very rich sharing, actually. So, you know, from kind of a mix of feelings, anxiety, despair, quite a few questions about flying and the ethics of that, really, kind of individual kind of conflicts around that, and people talking about various different actions like not having a car and working on not traveling long distances, and we were also talking about the development of compassion. Guyasaki was talking about, hope you didn't mind me saying, but talking about the importance of building.
Sorry, compassion. I prefer to be, if it's feedback from a group, just be anonymous.
Oh, okay, sorry. Right. Yeah.
Otherwise,
yeah.
I can always
share. That's absolutely fine.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Just because it makes it fair.
Yeah, that's fine.
I can
fine.
Speak with my own voice.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay,
thank
that's
you.
Fine. Yeah.
Appreciate you asking. Thanks.
So we're talking about compassion, really, and having compassion for ourselves and what we are able to do, working with and turning towards difficult emotions like guilt and shame, but with a lot of tenderness, I think. A lot of compassion for ourselves. Because I think we all struggle with the things we feel we ought to be doing and the things we are able to do. And that's, in a way, that struggle is a fertile ground, isn't it? That struggle is the ground of our practice. But it feels important to be able to maintain a level of tenderness and compassion for ourselves within that, because that's not always easy. Facing the feelings that are really difficult. So we were talking from an emotional level and from a practical level too. I'll leave it there, and then if anyone else from my group wants to share anything, please feel free.
Now, in my group, so I'm talking a lot, but in my group, we were talking about starting with ourselves and using the Brahma Viharas and positive emotion and, you know, starting with ourselves, and then we can influence those around us, which can then influence those around them. So it felt like felt quite empowering, really. There was certainly a sense of because I know somebody in Manchester, well, obviously I won't say, but the person got very overwhelmed and had to drop out of the direct action because of what became of, you know, that situation. So there's definitely, I mean, I think as a support network, I think the Trivana Earth Sangha is, you know, that's to me, it's a big advantage of having this context and these people, you know, so you're not alone in this fight. You can take it out, you can be strong. Starting with yourself, but yeah, in good company, taking it out and yeah, making a difference, sort of, hopefully, to everyone else in the world who really needs to hear our voice, really. I don't want to feel that I was being like a preacher or holier than thou, because I think that's that could be a near enemy to those people that would have heard what I was saying but didn't like the way in which I was saying it. So I don't want to be a preacher. I just want to hopefully lead by example, and hopefully people can kind of cotton on, and the kids can say, oh, you know, dad's into doing this, so, you know, we can get something together, and their friends can get something together, because it's them that are going to be affected so much by the world as it could be if nothing gets done. So anyway, yeah, I'll stop now. But any other groups wanna share anything?
Well, we.
I would. Oh,
please, Cornelia.
Okay, I would like to summarize what we did, what we talked about. The first is do good and talk about it, so people know what you're doing and how great it is. And the second is use your practice to recover and build up strength. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, we were the the second German speaking group. We kind of continued this discussion about Triratna taking stance to political questions or individuals, and well, we all agreed that Triratna is, well, it's not an organization, so it cannot have a certain position. But I think we also agreed that at least us in the group, we all are concerned about things going on in society and about climate change in particular. And it would be great to have more awareness among individuals in our movement. And then the question, of course, is how do you raise these questions? If you take flying as an example, can be quite you can raise this question in a quite polarizing way, and this will certainly not be helpful. But at the same time, it is an open question somehow. And other questions. And so we were discussing about how do we address questions of what's going on in the world in the Sangha. And well, we also came back to I think it was last year's conference when Saraha spoke about the 4C of activism, and I just found it, was confronting, caring, or be creative, and changing consciousness. And it's a good way to, well, there are different ways of being active, of being, well, so to speak, an activist, and it needn't be part of a political project or being part of Extinction Rebellion. It can be, you can do something in your daily life. That's the most important thing, because not everybody can be an activist, but it would be certainly nice if everybody reflected on what can I do here now in my life to have a positive influence on the world.
Yeah, and our group as well was talking about the 1,000 Avalokiteshvara, because in terms of like the order being, you know, playing to its strengths basically. So for example, I couldn't be on the street with a banner on a march because of my health condition, but I could create social media presence, which could then work in favour. I could create websites, or I could, you know, talk at conferences, you know, for example. So I don't think everyone needs to address the climate crisis in the same way, because I can't, which I've had to kind of deal with through my Buddhist practices that are the foundation for everything. So just move forward positively.
We talked about anger in our group.
Oh, yeah.
Interesting conversation about how people's experience had been, you know, that maybe they weren't allowed to experience anger, or if experiencing anger was somehow wrong or inappropriate, and distinguishing between anger and ill will, which I thought was interesting. And it was almost as if, you know, anger is this sort of primal energy that is in itself, can itself be quite neutral, whereas, you know, when it, as soon as it finds an object of aversion, then it becomes obviously tainted with ill will. So we're talking about the importance of not sitting on your anger, of acknowledging that it's there, of being okay with being angry, and how, yeah, that energy can then be harnessed, you know, in a positive way, and that, because you need energy to sort of be an activist and you know, to do anything much. So it was an interesting conversation, particularly that distinction between anger and aversion, if you like. So how, you know, the virya, I suppose, I mean, you know, you can kind of turn it into energy in pursuit of the good, if you're kind of aware enough and are integrated enough.
Mm-hmm. That's so interesting. Yeah. It's like there is anger, and anger has arisen. It's not I'm angry at you, it's just that there is anger, and that can be transformed into energy in pursuit of the good by, like you say, by integration. Which again is, you know, so practice is key to that. So we need to, you know, practice ethics, practice meditation in order to go out into the world.
So another thing we just discussed in our group was habitual reactions and, you know, teachings around finding the gap. And I guess that would be one thing around anger. If you find that your response is constantly to feel angry, then perhaps to develop a practice where you could step back from it and look at it and be a bit curious about it and see, you know, whether there's a better response. And it came up in the context of Palestine, and we were discussing, and there was a guy on the radio a couple of days ago, and he said that, in fact, the most skillful response the Israelis could have made in the face of Hamas was to be kind, serious acts of kindness. And it's sort of counterintuitive. But also I was thinking about what Jenny said this morning in the donut talk. You know, she said because there's a definition of rational economic man, actually it's amazing how we all behave as rational economic man. And I guess because there are treaties that deal with war and say we're allowed to defend ourselves, we all, you know, gather around that. But I don't think we spent much time on the last question, which is, you know, what needs to happen next in the world. And of course, you know, who knows? But you feel like everything needs tipping on its head, and our practice of finding the gap is actually a really good practice to get curious and find counterintuitive ways of looking at this.
Yeah, thanks, Lou. But I wonder, because I remember reading something in your book about you know, how to deal with anger and ill will and what we can do about this. I wonder if you could say anything about that.
Thank you. Well, I think Akash Raja summarized it just a little while ago when he said, just be very clear the difference, that there is a difference between anger and ill will. Ill will being always unskillful because it's wishing other people harm, whereas anger can just be a sudden bursting forth of energy. So if it's a sudden bursting forth of energy, well, what's behind that? What's coming, you know, what's the motivation? What's the value or the longing behind that sudden bursting forth of energy? It might be a longing for fairness or justice. It might be a longing for compassion, actually, a longing for compassion to be alive in the world. Yeah. So I talk about trying to find the life in our anger, rather than trying to sort of squash it down or repress it, which obviously doesn't work, or at least doesn't work for me anyway. So trying to find the life in my anger and our anger, so that we can actually somehow, yeah, if we could transform it, if we could find the life in it, it would be a tremendous energy, tremendous burning energy, you know. That's what comes up for me. And while I've got the floor, I'd like to, I'd really appreciated, Buddhasevaka, your image of the thousand-armed Avalokiteshvara, actually, because that's how I see us here on this screen, as a kind of periodic gathering of the arms, so to speak, that are particularly interested in this, these emergencies. And what we can do is we can talk to each other. We can tell each other what we're doing. So we know that this arm is doing something over here and this arm. So we can tell each other. We don't all have to be doing the same thing, clearly. We might all be doing quite differentiated functions of that organism. That's fine, as far as I can tell. But telling each other what we're doing with our particular arm or arms. And also, I'd really like to hear, you know, what's easy and what's difficult, you know, for your arm, as it were, for, you know, are there things that are really challenging and difficult where you could really do with some support? Or, you know, are there places where the arms are just pushing against an open door and it seems quite easy, you know, sort of like there are some centers that have already got Tree Ratna Earth Sangha groups set up and seem to be flourishing and so forth, so on and so forth. Yeah. So that's the kind of communication I'm very interested in here.
If anyone wants to set up a Earth Sangha at your own local centre, then I'm buddhasevaka@gmail.com. And please do it. Please get in touch and I'll post the email in the chat. But it's just absolutely imperative that we do this, as far as I can tell. Let's see if I can... Yeah, we've got a flourishing local conveners group, and it would be great to have you on board as well. And Essen in Germany, Berlin, and Sheffield are very very active and just kind of growing all the time. I think there was a Spanish contingent as well in before that have since gone, but this is a crisis that we need to address. But we have got the tools, like Helen was saying, we've got the tools in place to address those. You know, we can start with ourselves. We can start with positive emotion integration, then move on and use our anger and virya as force for good in the world. So like I say, our group was very very positive in that way. So it's definitely a sense of I tend to be sometimes quite nihilistic with my outlook about the way the climate's going. But my partner just pulls me into one side and just said, it's going to be okay. In any kind of, obviously, it's not okay, but it could be addressed. It can be addressed. It's not a lost cause, which I sometimes quite often need to be reminded about. Perhaps I need to practice the metta bhavana more, maybe.
Just wondering.
Can I say something? Sorry, Priya, go ahead.
I was just wondering if we heard from both of the German groups. I think we've heard from one of them.
He was speaking for the second German group. So,
no, we heard both.
Yeah.
Yes, the first and me, the second group.
Oh, great, yeah. Sorry, Helen.
No, I was just going to say, in a way, it was kind of echoing what Shanti Garba said, because I guess these sort of gatherings, human beings are endlessly creative, aren't we? And this is, it feels to me like it's a really organic process, and we're feeling our way towards more and more skillful ways of managing this. And so that's part of what's really fruitful about these, about the online conference and the online retreats that the Tree Ratna Sangha Heart Conveners group organise. It's just, yeah, thank you so much for doing that, because it's gathering people together. And we can inspire each other. I've been inspired massively by all the things I've heard, of all the people I've spoken to today, and all the things I've heard on the presentations. And that's fueling us, isn't it? That's fueling us all to find more and more creative ways of being in the world and responding to this.
Yeah, thank you, Helen. Yeah, so has anybody got anything they want to share?
Ethan's got his hand up.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sorry, Ethan.
I was just, the thought came to mind, which is about not knowing. Sort of, I think Lou mentioned about being in the gap. And for me, I find the experience of being in relationship with the climate crisis deeply painful. But I think the thought arose in relation to what you said, Buddhasevaka, which is this idea that actually we don't know the effects of our actions necessarily. And we don't know what the future will bring about, or what future we will bring about, possibly a better way of phrasing it. And I find that I prefer the comfort of certainty to with my habitual views and my habitual ways of responding, rather than being able to say, actually, this is painful, but I don't know what the future will hold. But because I don't know what the future will hold, I want to try to respond in a creative and compassionate way. I think I just spoke myself into a thought.
Idea. Yeah. Can I just add, so that it might be helpful in relation to that, Ethan. So I looked into climate cafes on the internet, and the first thing it took me to was an organization called the Climate Reality Project, which is something I'd never heard before. And we sort of discuss XR, and you know, there are other things out there. I think that was set up by Al Gore, and what its approach seems to be is educating about issues surrounding climate change. And I think sometimes, as you say, it's worth expanding your understanding so that you're not slipping back into, you know, the reactions that make you perhaps feel safe, but also unsafe and frightened. And that, anyway, I just thought this organization might have some answers. It looks like it does some good training and good stuff. There's a Climate Reality Europe, and I saw that there was a UK branch that went to the big one in London.
Also, there's training with the Climate Psychology Alliance. They do some really good training as well.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that.
Yes. Can you just speak to something that Ethan said, Buddhasevaka?
Yeah, of course.
So about, you know, we don't know, like residing in not knowing, but knowing that, you know, having a sort of confidence that our actions will have consequences. And I was thinking that in the context of, you know, I was thinking about optimism and pessimism. You know, people, you said like your partner's an optimist, and I've got people who say, describe themselves as pessimists. But I tend to think that neither optimism or pessimism are particularly dharmic ideas. Because neither of them really takes conditionality into account. So if you're an optimist, you just have this sort of idea that it'll all turn out fine somehow. And if you're a pessimist, you think, oh, it's just all going to go down the tubes, regardless of what happens. And I think we need to steer clear of those extremes and just have faith that actions have consequences. So as Ethan was saying, you know, that whatever good we do, you know, collectively and individually, does have an effect. You know, we've talked about the ripple effect earlier on in this session. And I think, you know, that's a position that we can really trust in, you know, that you know, the laws of karma, and, you know, who knows, the Dharma Nirma as well. I mean, who knows what kind of dharmic effects our kind of work and our positive intention and, you know, our striving can trigger.
Yeah, the first month that we did a big sit in Manchester, there were about 35 people. I was like, oh my God, this is excellent. But unfortunately, as time went on, the numbers went down. And I was a bit despondent. I thought, oh, you know, this isn't having the same sort of impact as perhaps it could have if we'd been more strong in number. But like you say, you know, that have confidence that there is some good being done. You know, actions have consequences, and you know, we might not see it overtly, but we can trust that it's there.
So it just struck me, I mean, just as a very practical suggestion, could you imagine getting together with people at your center and organizing a climate cafe at your center, or people at your center? Could you imagine, just as a very practical suggestion, as a way of spreading out from this meeting? Yeah, just bring some tea and biscuits or whatever is the local equivalent, cafe und kuchen maybe, and invite people to have a conversation about this, you know. So that would be one very concrete way that we could take this forward, take this out into the world. Okay.
I do.
Thank you.
I think we're at time, so thanks everyone for absolutely valuable, invaluable contributions. And go well to the next session. Okay, thanks everyone.
Thanks everyone. Thanks, Buddhasevaka.
Thank you.
Thanks, Buddhasevaka. The next session is a Koopa, and that will start in half an hour exactly.
That's going to be a brilliant one, by the way.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Buddhasevaka.
Thank you, Ron.
Bye.